tov chavrim. It's a pleasure to get to be with you guys. And let me first, I'd like to start off real quick. This is going to be a short little message here. I will be coming back later tonight, going deeper into this with you as I'm studying this. If I don't make it tonight with a video, I'll publish it tomorrow. I got a hold of the Hebrew version of Matthew's Gospel. It is historically more accurate. Well, it's what Matthew wrote. He did not write in Greek. It's not what the Vatican would like you to have. They don't want you to know about this Bible. But I wanted to share this with you. First off, too, I'd like to real quick just greet my brother-in-law, Moya Ba, who is in the Prague. And I'd like to greet you, Akosamash. As we would say in Hebrew, Achi, Akosamash Moya Miliham Cha Stefan. Anyway, that's to my brother-in-law in Prague. Hopefully we'll get a chance to see him before too long, because we are headed home to Israel soon, and we may have a possibility of getting to see him over in Israel or something along that line. Anyway, real quick, I want to just share something with you here. And in reading the book of Matthew in the Hebrew form, and by the way, if you'd like to get some confirmation of the authenticness of this book, there's a lot of sources out there, but Nechami Gordon, there's a lot of people I know respect Nechami and his research. He's a Hebraic scholar. I'm acquainted with Nechami as well. And he really kind of got me stirred up about wanting to read this for myself. And it's as accurate as you're going to get as far as the Hebrew version. But he mentioned George Howard had actually done a book about this. Now, George does translate it. However, his translations are fairly accurate. They're not exactly what I would call perfect. But what has surprised me are there are some key verses that it is obvious the Vatican doesn't want you to know what's really said in the true text. They want you to know only from the Greek. So ironically, even when you're reading in the Greek, normally if the word is not there, they just have to do it in order to get the sentence to flow. They'll put it in italics. Well, in this case here, they don't put it in italics because they're translating you the book of Matthew from the Septuagint or whatever version that they have. Another book I'm reading that's very interesting is a book called Why They Changed the Bible by David Daniels. And I can see why. I haven't even got a chance really to read this book as of yet. Brother Austin from North Carolina gave this book to me, and God bless that brother and his family up there in North Carolina. Precious, precious people up there. I love them very much. All the brothers and sisters up there, and I'm not great on names. I remember Brother Doug and also Brother Paul as well. Really precious people there, Brother Austin and his lovely wife and friends that are there. But at any rate there, I want to share with you just a few verses here that I have looked at. And this is in the 26th chapter. Okay, in the 26th chapter is where, I've done quite a few of the chapters already, but I just want to share with you a few things here, because I think it's important that you're aware of this. And let's look at, for example, we'll start with verse 10. And it says, in the King James Version of the Bible there, we read here, "When Jesus understood it, he said unto them, Why trouble ye the woman? For she hath wrought a good work upon me." Now, that's not bad. That's nice translation there. We're talking about Mary who had came and poured the ointment over Yeshua and they were complaining. It's actually Judas, from what I understand, that was complaining, you know, about this oil could have been used to feed the poor, could have been sold. And Yeshua knew, though, that it was done for a reason. And he says, you know, why have you troubled her? Let me just read it again. "When Jesus understood it, he said unto them, Why trouble ye the woman? For she hath wrought a good work upon me." Now, the first part in verse 10 is what I want to focus on here. "When Jesus understood it, he said unto them." Now, Let's take a look at what Matthew actually writes in here. And I'm going to translate this for you here. He says, Ve'yeshua hayadat kol deba, or kol devao, okay? And when Yeshua, who knows all things, la'azeh anin na'asa, who knows everything regarding any matter. Now that just blew me away. Here, Matthew is saying about Yeshua, he knows everything. Basically, like, regardless of what the matter might be, he knows it. In other words, you couldn't hide your life from him if you wanted to. And it doesn't matter what you think or do, he already knows it. And so it's kind of funny how that through the different translations of the Bible, they have lost it. And of course, and I think a lot of times it has to do with doctrinal issues. But he goes on to say, are you making occasion against this woman? Truly, she has performed a good and wonderful deed toward me. See, are you making an accusation against this woman? You know, because as he point out, Jesus knew everything at any time. He knew it. And that's amazing. No wonder why they smote him. And they would hit him in the back of the head and stuff and say, tell us who hit you. Actually, they said Messiah. Tell us who hit you, Messiah. Mashiach. Tell us who hit you. Let's move over to verse 23. And it says here, and he answered and said, he that dippeth his hand with me in the dish, the same shall betray me. Now this is, as we know, the whole chapter 26 is going into Yeshua's final hours. And so, you know, his burial is prepared by Mary when she anoints him with the oil. Then they prepare the Passover meal. They're getting ready. And we come to this place here in verse 23. They're gathered together. They're already breaking bread. They're dipping it in some kind of little sauce or something there. Maybe juice from the lamb. I don't know what it was. But anyhow, they're dipping their bread into this bowl. And Yeshua says here, according to the Greek translation, and he answered and said to them, he that dippeth his hand with me in the dish, the same shall betray me. But in the actual Hebraic language here, he says, he answered them, he who dips his hand with me in the dish will sell me. That's a little interesting. Well, betraying is one thing, but selling is exactly what they did to Joseph as well. Of course, we know it's still the same type. But here's what we don't read, because it's not written in the King James Bible. He says here, all of them were eating from one dish, therefore they did not recognize him. Who's him? The man that would betray him. So they weren't sure who it was because they were all eating. And Yeshua said, the one that's eating here among you is the one that will do it. So you have to remember, in this regards here, Judas's life was no different from the rest of them. He was a believer, appeared to be a believer, lived that life, walked the same way, did the same things, but Yeshua gives it away. And so they didn't know. But watch what else they said. Because if they had recognized him, they would have destroyed him. That's interesting. No wonder why God has kept the knowledge of the Antichrist away from the true believers and the identity of who the Antichrist is. Because he knows that the people would destroy the Antichrist if they really knew who it was. If they knew for a fact who the Antichrist is, the Antichrist would be destroyed. But nonetheless, the Antichrist, just as Judas, was serving a purpose. And so I found that kind of interesting as well. Now there's actually a beautiful, and this is what I'm going to get into with you guys later in a study here. I'm going to show you some beautiful things that God has revealed to me. And ironically, it's going to be about the two witnesses, because we see the antitype in here. And we're going to talk about the Antichrist, because a lot of times people think the only place that was ever spoken about the Antichrist was in John's writing, when he writes about the Antichrist, and then later in Revelation he speaks of the false prophet. Well, no, Matthew does as well. And I would imagine if we could get the Hebrew version of all the rest of the Gospels, which I'm sure they were all written this way as well, we would probably find out that Mark and Luke as well speak of the Antichrist. Well, Yeshua is quoted by Matthew and literally uses that Greek terminology, antichristos is what he says in Hebrew. Antichristos is what he calls him. But we'll get into that a little bit later. That's actually a little bit before this part here. Verse 32, let's read this in the King James. But after I am risen again, I will go before you into Galilee. Now, this is a simple one here, but I want to read to you literally what he says here. Ve'achare kumi machamiyata agila lechem begalil. Begalil, begalil, or in Galilee. Okay? The egala, or gala, is the key word here, and that word literally means revealed. Now, even the author of this book here, when he translates it, he puts it, after my resurrection from death, I will be revealed to you in Galilee. Now, the second half there, it's accurate, but the first half, it actually doesn't, it's pretty close, but it actually says, and after from death, I will rise. Okay, after death I rise, I will be revealed to you in Galilee. And I just thought that's a little interesting. I know, but after I am risen again, this King James, I will go before you into Galilee. But, and I guess you could take it the same way, but I just think it's interesting that he says he'll be revealed to them in Galilee. So, some little interesting insights here. Now, let's go to verse 38 and 39. This was another interesting one. In King James we have, then saith he unto them, my soul is exceedingly sorrowful, even unto death. Tarry ye here, and watch with me. Verse 39, and he went a little farther, and fell on his face, and prayed, saying, O my Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as thou wilt. Now, let's take a look at this in the Hebraic language here, what he says here. He says, then he said to them, my soul is grieved unto death. Support me and watch with me. It's pretty much the same thing. You could translate it either way. Then he goes on to here, he says, Lehayot chasad na memini. Oh, I'm sorry, reading the wrong place. Ve'yelech la'et me'et. Ve'yafal al panav, okay? And so he says here, just like it says in the King James, and he slowly went forward a little and fell on his face and prayed and said, okay, now let's get back here to where it's at in the Hebrew, ve'yatafalal, which means, and he prayed, ve'yomer, and he said, im yachol, okay, if it can Lahayot be possible, chasa na memini, chakos chazeh. Let this cup be taken away, you know, passed from me or taken away from me, okay? So if it is possible, take this cup from me. Now, ironically, he doesn't even say my Father. Doesn't say he prayed and said my Father. He doesn't write that at all, you know? Now we realize it's understood, but my issue is, if someone is willing to inject their own thought into that and not say what is said, what happens with the rest of the Word of God? And of course, you read the book by David Daniels, you'll find out there's all kinds of things they do in order to be able to inject doctrinal thinking. Now, he goes on to say, now the writer here translates the rest of this, take this cup from me, indeed, let it not be as I will, but according to your will. Now, as I begin to look at that myself, he says here, let me get back to where we're at here. Not like that which I want, but as you wish. And that's what I thought was kind of interesting. He says, he's actually saying, Aminam lokamo she'ani rotze yachia. See? Not like that which I want, or that I will want, you might say. See? But as you wish. Now the word here, alal karasonecha, I keep wanting to look for a camera over to the left there, I don't know why. That, It's of course it's a compounded word here, but the word what it is is a wish or it's a desire, but not, in other words, not my will, but what your desire is. But here's what's beautiful about this. This is why I think it's important to understand the translations. This word here, when you're saying this here, this is like the wish of a prisoner. This is the wish that he is asking. In other words, not my will, God, not mine. Well, he's not even saying God, but he says, not like that which I want, but what your wish is as a prisoner. In other words, Yeshua had given himself as a prisoner. See, as a prisoner, in order to complete the very will of God that is written regarding him. Now, it's more important to me in reading like this and knowing this, because now I understand why Paul says, I am a prisoner to Christ. Because Yeshua uses the same terminology when Matthew writes about it. Yeshua is using the exact same terminology. He became a prisoner to the will of God. Not his own will, not his own fleshly desire, not his own flesh that wanted to bypass if it could be done, but he wanted to, he came subject as a man, as a human being, to the very will of the words that were written that he would do. And this is just, oh my gosh, it's just endless in here. Another one that I thought was interesting. This is verse 53. Wow. Now, I trust this is a blessing for you, and don't want to shoot me after I say these things, because I'm just telling you what he says, what Matthew actually wrote in the Hebraic language. I mean, he was a Jew, he spoke Hebrew. And here it comes here. Let me back up a little bit so we get the whole scenario here. Verse 51, and behold, one of them which were with Jesus stretched out his hand and drew his sword and struck a servant of the high priest and smote off his ear. Then said Yeshua, or Jesus, I'm reading King James, Jesus unto him, put up again thy sword into his place, for all they that take the sword shall perish with the sword. Thinkest thou that I cannot now pray to my Father, and he shall presently give me more than 12 legions of angels? Now, this is what's going to be tough, guys. I know it is, because you got to understand, and I'm going to back up here and read the whole thing for you as well from what he says here in the Hebraic language. But that's kind of like, you know, well, let me just read it to you. Behold, one who was with Yeshua stretched out his hand, drew his sword, struck one of the servants of the priest, and cut off his ear. Now, that's exactly the same, pretty much almost word for word. And Yeshua said to him, return your sword to its sheath, for the sword will fall, for those who draw the sword will fall by the sword. Now, the word those who draw doesn't say that. It's just in order to kind of make it understand. Literally, it says for the sword will fall by the sword, or you could say for he that uses the sword will die by the sword. But I don't like that adding those words in there unless you know that it's something to make the sentence complete. All right. Verse 53, though, this is the kicker right here, boy. This is what Yeshua now says, okay? Now, of course, Matthew didn't type, or he didn't handwrite and read, but this is what he said Yeshua says. Do you not understand that I can meet my enemies, and indeed there will be for me at once more than 12 legions of angels? Now, I don't see the first word in here, Diphilah. I don't see him saying the word in Hebrew. I'll pray. I don't see him saying something about my Father. Nothing. See? Halo tivein shochel lafaga'a be'avi achin li ata yoter. See? It's just like instantly. You know? Do you not understand? Halo tivein shochel. See, do you not understand that I can meet my enemies? And indeed there will be for me at once more than 12 legions of angels. Yeshua's not taking time to do no prayer or nothing. When he's going to take and meet his enemies, they will be there when he has need of it. There's no waiting, no needing to go pray and find somebody to get help. Do you not understand that I can meet my enemies, and indeed there will be for me at once more than 12 legions of angels? But it's just over and over and over and over and over. Another one here, I believe. And Jesus saith unto them, Thou hast said, Nevertheless I say unto you, hereafter shall you see the Son of Man sitting on the right hand of power and coming in the clouds of heaven. Now, let's see what he says here. Yeshua answered him, You say it, but again I say to you, you have yet to see the Son of God sitting at the right of the power of God coming on the clouds of heaven. Now, literally in Hebrew, he says, Ben Ha'el, see, the Son of God, Yoshev sitting, Layamin Gibor Ha'el, sitting to the right. Gibor is mighty, to the right, or the right might of God. Bo ba'avi shachachim. So, coming in the clouds of heaven. I mean, oh my God. You guys, I tell you what, this is just a blessing. And I have wanted for years. I did not even know that I could actually access this book. And I have just, you know, been sitting here and enjoying it immensely. Anyway, let me just real quick, we'll come back to this because I want to share with you guys some things that that I saw in the process of this. Not anything that you wouldn't already know. But we are returning home, and we're pretty much set to go now. And I can't divulge as far as the timeline on that or the time frame. But I can tell you now, within just a matter of weeks, we'll be home. And so I'm asking that you would pray for us in our return home. As you know, the tensions in Israel are very, very high right now. And there's a lot of expectation as far as what God will do in the very coming months for Israel. Whether it be the coming months, coming weeks, whatever, I have no idea. But if you believe in this ministry, if you believe that God has called us to reach to my own people, and since we've been here, we've had more people, Jewish people from Israel, that have been listening, that need help, that I'm hoping to go back home and help them to know more about Yeshua and to be a blessing to them. And I don't know where God will lead. I'd never step out of the line of God's leading. I want Him to be the one that leads. And so if you believe that God is, this ministry is anointed of God, and that it's for the purpose to spread the gospel unto the Jewish people as well as the Gentiles, and you want to be a part of that, we just ask you to prayerfully consider that. And if you desire, if the Lord lays it on your heart, you can give online on our website. There's a donation place there, IsraelReturns.com, or if you prefer by mail, some people do. We still have time to receive mail for the next couple of weeks, and you could do that. And of course, we still would be able to receive mail even if we're not here. We are changing, though, our address here in Florida eventually will change. Now, that won't change for the first 3 months, but we are going to be moving from here because, well, actually, looks like we have a place now in Israel that we'll be going to. But we'll get everything set up later. Our mail can safely come here, though, for a couple of more months. If there is a change, we'll let you know. We'll put it on the website. But if you don't hear from me right here on YouTube telling you that there's been a change, don't believe it, because I've had so many times where spam has gone out saying to people I'm in trouble in some country and stuff. It's nonsense. I'll come talk to you directly here, so you'd see my face if there's something going on. And Also, I believe Sister Lisa, I haven't spoke with her yet, but I'm sure she'll also be doing a fundraising for the trip to Israel. So other than that, no one has, would not be doing that, period. She's the only one that has that ability to do so. But anyway, I'm sorry, but as far as our address, it's 12537 Gemstone Court. That's G-E-M-S-T-O-N-E. Should appear at the bottom of your screen. Fort Myers, Florida, 33913. Your prayers, though, is more critical than anything else in the world, is your prayers for this trip, for the leading of God. I'll be praying about it. I really encourage you as well, pray for Israel more than you ever have. Really pray for them, because if the hour is coming, the God will send the two witnesses. The two witnesses not only are going to be a blessing to Israel, they're going to bless the world. Because there, and this is a message we'll get into later, something that the Lord is showing me about this. It's going to cause the people, one, to know what the divine name of God is, and you will also know the identity of God. They're going to reveal a lot of things. And so I know there'll be a blessing. And I know I've said enough. I've said too much as it is already. We love you. We thank you for being a part of this ministry and helping us. And just can't say enough gratitude towards you guys and the love that you show and have for us here. Anyway, God bless you. Baruch Hashem. I cannot wait to share with you not just the translation difference, but I want to share with you a beautiful message that the Lord has shared with me here. And so I'll prepare more tonight for that. And I think I'll just wait till Monday to share that with you. That way I can get a little bit deeper into it so you understand me better. God bless you. I love you.